Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the Fan Zone. As you can see, it's load shedding. It's load shedding here in the shack. Let me just see if we can, yeah.
I almost say good morning.
Okay, what's happening, everybody? Welcome to Let's Talk at the Fan Zone. As you can see, we got Mr. Nibbles in the house. We would like to send a huge shout out to the Nibbles family for our goodies and our treats.
Let's make the mission.
Guys, today, 3-course meal. There's chicken something something, there's samosas, there's donuts, and it was, what's in it?
Vedas.
Vedas. We are good to Vedas. Those things are dangerous. But anyway, welcome to it. We are week 4 of our cancer edition.
Can you believe it?
Of our cancer month.
I can't believe
it. I'm feeling lucky. Are we lopsided here? Yo, guys, what must happen now?
No, we're not lopsided. Now we lobs.
Okay, I don't know,
okay.
But anyway,
okay,
we're like
fine.
Not level.
We are level,
but anyway, nevertheless, we are here. We got a huge shout out that we would like to do. First and foremost, our show sponsors for this evening, Good Friday and the Nibbles family. Right. So without
and
further
Glamours.
Ado. Oh, and sorry, and Glamours. And CJ Photography, as you can see. A very nice t-shirt you're wearing there, man.
Thank you very much.
Suit. Brings out the
pink
color in your
good
eyes.
On me.
Yes, so good evening, guys. We balanced. Okay, so there are a lot of announcements. I'm going to try and get through them while I've got like 7 seconds. Because you guys, this is all I say for like the entire show. But anyway. Guys, we got a raffle goodie.
You've been saying it for the past 2 months.
Yes, it is all I say. I burst with excitement. This is my time to shine.
And you've got one more week to say it.
Guys.
Your last week to say it.
Lisa, good evening to you. But that's Roz's thing. She'll jump into the greetings in a bit. Modern Hair and Beauty has come on board. We would like to send a huge shout out to them. So thank you for the stuff that they've given us with regards to the raffle. I've got it live in the studio, guys. I wish I knew
there's
what
no
the products...
space for that on the table. It is so big.
I wish I knew what the products actually entail. All I do know is that it's a male and a female hamper with a beach bag and some hair brushes and stuff like that. So as you guys are aware, we are raffling that out. It's 20 rand a ticket. Please can you guys send through your names, send through your numbers, so that we can bill you guys, send your invoice later. That raffle will be raffled when we go live at our Shaverton on Sunday. Can you believe it, guys? We are a few days away from our second Shaverton. It is like un-freaking believable. We do this planning for like a year and you just blink and the month is gone. So our Shaverton on Sunday starts at 10 o'clock. We're up at Hillcrest. If you guys are free, you're more than welcome to come and join us, come and see us, come take some snaps. The kids enjoy the spraying, so if you've got some kids and would like to spray their hair, bring them through. If you want to shave your hair, you guys can come through and catch us there, up in Hillcrest. It's like another country, guys, so it's a bit cold and chilly there. The sun might be out in Durban, but there it's like another planet. So, yeah, but we're there from 10 till about 3-ish. If you guys can come through, please do. Is there anything? Oh, Good Friday. We would like to say a huge shout out to Good Friday. Mr. Nibbles will unpack his gift during the course of the show. Most probably when we are doing his, stop playing his song. We've got a few birthdays, we've got weddings, we've got anniversaries to Zane Coles and his wife, Nazarene. We would like, they got married on the weekend, so we would like to just wish you guys well. And all the best
to many more.
To all the butters that we've missed, please drop your name in the comments department. Any special goodies that we've missed, just drop it there so that we can congratulate you guys or wish you guys accordingly.
Okay.
Now,
oh, go for it. Okay, so before I greet everybody, I just want to highlight a group of guys, a very special group of guys that though the Amishova bike, what do you call it, a bike challenge?
Bike race.
A bike race over the weekend. We went through to Rovers to actually meet the guys. We did a snippet on the Saturday, and then we went through to Rovers to actually meet the guys. What an awesome group of guys. They managed 2 days. On our show, when we did the interview with them, they were sitting at 45K. By the end of the evening, they were sitting on 51.5K. So they've managed today's 51.5K.
Yeah, yeah.
I am totally in awe of that amount for cancer. So they rode for cancer. You can go and you can have a look at the interview. We did interview them on Sunday, as well as the kits that they wore. And they are actually wanting to do this next year. So watch out for them next year. We did meet a very special person as well. His name is Keon. So this is one of the, they were riding for Keon. Keon had retinoblastoma. He's had a tumor removed from behind his eye. And guys, this week's supposed to be the end of our cancer interviews. But we met Keon, and we met Keon's mom and dad, and we've decided that we are going to interview them next week Wednesday. So this is not our last show on cancer. Next week Wednesday, we'll be interviewing Keon, his mom, and his dad. The Amishova guys rode in honor of Keon. How old is he? 3 years old?
Yeah.
3 year old. What a happy 3 year old, guys. So we thought, we were so delighted to meet him, and we want to bring him on the show so everybody else can meet him. His mother has opened the page to follow his journey. So if you go onto Facebook and you search Keon's journey, you can like the page, and she's got all the information that you need on that page. So we have a few people in the comments department tonight. So good evening, Auntie Sybil. Good evening, Tanu. Okay, so Tanu is the daughter of the handsome Mr. Nibbles here. Okay, then Elizabeth. Oh, another family member. Good evening to you, Elizabeth. We have Vanessa. Hi, Vanessa. Welcome to the Fan Zone. Well, Mrs. Nibbles is here with us in studio. Hi, Yadiba. Who else we have? Hi, Rolly. Hi, Tyler. Hi, Allison. Hi, Lisa J. Hi, Sheridan. Sheridan, we'll see you on Sunday. Hello, Auntie G. Hi, Martine. Hi, Jody. Shade, so nice to see you. Uncle Marvin. I almost said Uncle Mark, but Uncle Marvin.
No, <it's good.
laughs> Uncle Marvin. So, guys, we only have an hour. Hi, Plincy. I see you there. So, guys, as you know, this year we focused on the social impact of cancer. So we interviewed people that have lost a loved one to cancer. So that's a mum, a dad, a sibling, a fiance that you have.
Sorry, can I just cut you short while I've got the guys in the comments department? Jody and Rolly are our DJs, right? And they run Euphoria Bespoke, okay? So they have actually donated beautiful... like, Roz has plotted
my
many.
My favorite.
My mother has plotted many. Like, I don't know if I'll even have suckies for the Shaverton. But anyway, guys, when you guys come through to the Shaverton, you will see these little goodies with the pink... They all fitting the theme and whatever the case may be, these beautiful pieces.
Uncle Wani.
That are up for grabs, obviously, at a donation. You guys will leave with this goodie. So a huge shout out to the guys from Euphoria Bespoke with their beautiful goodies that they have donated to us.
Guys, this year was so overwhelming because last year we actually went into the Shaverton with no sponsors. I mean, we had one or two people that sponsored, but this year we went into the Shaverton with clothing lines. I mean, Good Friday came to the party, Glamour's Clothing came to the party, African Swag came on last week.
Mm-hmm.
They came to the party with a special edition. We've got so many people, the Nibbles family, Chocks.
Yes, Balloons by Chock.
Balloons by Chock.
We've got
the Pound Club.
Yes.
There is so many, Euphoria Bespoke, there are so many sponsors that have come on board with us. The salons are huge. Thank you to us. But we're going to do an after show to thank everybody. But all our sponsors are on our page, so you can go and you can have a look at that.
Hello, Theo. And why is Aiden only waving at Roz? Can
Hi,
we just
Aiden.
Ask that? Okay. Wayne, good evening to you, buddy. A bit late, but
hi,
anyway,
Wayne.
Evening to you. Okay, you guys.
Okay,
thank you.
So without any further ado, we're going to let our guest introduce himself. He is no stranger to you guys. So over to you.
Warm welcome.
I'm Eugene Nagia, a.k.a. Mr. Nibbles.
Yes.
Been in Newlands for better part of my life, 27.
And knows everybody in Newlands. Everybody.
I think it's just my sporting background. But besides that, grew up in Kenville, lived in Phoenix, moved to Newlands, Effingamites as well. And yeah, I'm just me.
Okay, so Mr. Nibbles is on our show tonight because he lost his mum at 14 to cancer. So he was so kind to come onto the show and share his journey with us. So previously, with all the other interviews, we always start with a diagnosis because that is where it all starts.
Yeah.
So when you are 14 years old, how does your mum come to you and tell you, I've got cancer? Like, do you remember that moment?
Actually, it wasn't... I was 14 when she passed away.
Oh, okay.
And at about 11 and a half, 12 years old, my mom was getting sick. And she was suffering with stomach cramps and pains. And I was just 12. I didn't realize the implication of that. And it so happened that my one uncle took her to the doctors and they found out there were certain issues with her. And I didn't know any better, and neither was I told.
Hmm.
And being the eldest child, eventually, about 6 months later, I overheard my uncle and auntie speak, because my mom wasn't at home. She was in hospital, and then she came back to my granny's house in Effingamites, and we were living in Phoenix at that time. And then I overheard my uncle and aunt spoke that she's got cancer in the stomach.
Mm-hmm.
Which was already too late. At that time, there was no stages as such.
Oh, okay.
I'm talking about, this was in 1980.
The year I was born.
There we go.
I was 41 years ago.
I was just a 12-year-old youngster trying to enjoy life.
Mm-hmm.
And then it got progressively worse in terms of she was never at home because she was either by my granny's house or in hospital.
Okay.
And it was in and out. So my gran, my dad's mom and his sister moved into our house to look after myself and my brother.
Okay.
While we were in school. And obviously my dad was there. So we never got to see my mom regularly unless on the weekend. And at that time, it never really dawned on me what cancer was. Mm-hmm. I never knew anything about cancer. I was, like I said, 12 years old. And then she got progressively worse. And my mom was a very, as we would say back in the day, a healthy person.
Mm-hmm.
But she was a big woman. She must have weighed, I would probably say, 60 plus mm-hmm. kgs. And she started to lose weight. And she was going for treatment, but it didn't seem to help. Because eventually, in 1981, she said to the doctors, that's it. I am not coming to this hospital anymore. I'm going home.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when the doctors spoke to my dad and spoke to my uncles and said to them, listen, there's nothing more we can do.
Mm-hmm.
And I was called in and told by my one uncle, listen, this is a story. Your mom's sick, but we're going to look after her.
Mm-hmm.
And we had a doctor in Effingamites, Dr. Rambaran, that became... he was the family doctor, but he became more of a doctor.
Mm-hmm.
He became more of a confidant, more of a person mm-hmm. that everyone relied on. And mom came home, and eventually she got to a stage where she could not go to the toilet. She had a bag on the
mm-hmm.
side of
the
catheter. And I was in school. I was just entering high school then.
Okay.
When I was 13. And it became so bad that when I used to get home from school, she used to sit up in bed and I had to go and massage her back. Because the pain was such that it wasn't just the stomach, it was the back was worse. But that cancer had obviously traveled throughout her body. And she became just like a... She was basically bedridden for...
Okay.
But she could go to the toilet. We'll take her out just to take her for a walk. My gran and I used to take her for a walk. But just around the rooms. She never used to see the outside.
Okay, can I ask you, at 11, 12 years old, when you heard this word cancer, what did you think?
Honestly, nothing. At that age, being the child that I was, heavily involved in my sport and school, cancer wasn't something that I even looked up. I didn't even know what it was. I just knew it was a sickness.
Okay.
But I didn't know the repercussions of that or what it's going to cause.
Yes. So when your mom was obviously in the care of your grandmom, because obviously she was staying there so they could care for her, and then back to hospital and back to your grandmom, what did you think? Like, did you just think, okay, mom's sick and this is all going to be over? Or, like, did you think that, okay, this could be a possibility that I could lose my mom? Never. You never.
It never crossed my mind that my mom won't be around. Because I was very close to her.
Okay.
And
your brother, how old is your brother? What's the age?
He's 50.
So
no.
He's younger than you.
Yeah.
What's the, how many
years
apart? So it's 3 years apart. So he
well,
was,
yeah, 3 years.
You are 11, he must have been.
And he's deaf.
Oh, okay.
He was born deaf.
So did you take on the role of actually looking after your brother?
Yeah.
You did. You were in the same school. Were you in the same
school? No. He actually schooled at VNI.
Oh, okay. Okay.
And from the time he was, 3 years old. Initially, it used to be at Somsi Road. They were the deaf school in Somsi Road in the 70s. My mom used to take him to school, sit outside the school till he finished at about 11, 12 o'clock, bring him home, then wait for me to come from school, look after us. That was when we were living in Effingham Heights. And eventually, he never understood what was actually happening. Because he was young, and also, he's deaf. Now, he never understood what's actually going on. To him, mommy was just laying in bed.
Okay.
And when he was at VNAC, we actually had to put him into the boarding school at VNAC.
Oh, okay.
So that's one of the reasons VNAC is very close to my heart as well, in terms of what I do whenever I do it. But for me as a little boy, to see your mom like that, I didn't know what to expect. All I know is that mom is sick.
Okay.
The doctor is going to make her right at that time.
Okay. And you said that when you used to get home from school, when your mom was at home, she used to like you to massage her back.
Yeah.
So obviously those were like probably special moments.
Very,
for
very
you.
Special.
Okay. So what else did you... could you do, or how did you...
There was nothing more I could do for her in terms of relieving the pain that she was in. But what I could do was sit and talk to her.
Yes.
And she used to ask me how was my day at school, what homework I got, and she'll check, that kind of thing. And then I can still remember when I was 12, 13, I came home from school, we broke up, standard six, and she said to me, I've got money for you, you must take your brother and go to town and go and watch a movie.
Oh my word.
And we went to, I can't remember the movie, but I know it was at Shah Jahan in Gray Street. And we both went, watched the movie, and we got home.
You know, I know this is completely off check, but in a 12-year-old, 13-year-old, getting into a taxi.
No, it was a bus.
Getting into the bus and taking your brother to... I mean, you don't see that now.
No, we did it as a group of friends, because my friends that I had with me at that time growing up, we are still very good friends today. They are now in New Zealand. They knew that my mom was sick. And they used to come home and sit with me and give me company while my mom was doing whatever thing in upstairs.
Okay, tell me about that support, because this is exactly what we're trying to get at, like, you know, social impact.
My friends, their names are Mervin, Ravi, but I know them as, without, you know, the nicknames. They were Porky, Bones, Lumpy. Those guys were there for me all the time. They used, this one friend, Mervin's mum, was very close, and another friend of mine, Desmond as well, his mum and Mervin's mum became like the mother figure that I was craving. Because at that time, you know, we were interested in girls and shit like that. And, oh, sorry.
It's okay.
Only your kids are watching.
And, you know, they used to, when I used to be with them at their mother's, at their house, they'll tell mom, Mom, I met this girl today. And I was like, well, who do I say that to? And I used to say, then the one auntie, her name was Auntie Sushi. And she used to say to me, so Eugene, so who's the girl you like? I said, nah, there's no girl. I'm worried about soccer. I'm worried about soccer. She said, yeah, I know soccer, but you must like a girl. But those are the things that, as a youngster, I wanted to experience. But I couldn't really do that with mom. Because if I told her something today, tomorrow she'd never remember it.
Okay. She had stomach cancer, but what I gather, it affected her memory.
It affected her whole body. It affected her whole life, basically. And back then, there was no such treatment as such, you know, to make it easier.
And the support from your family. Obviously, immense. Your family took the role of looking after your mom and then after looking after you guys. How did that play a role in your helping you to cope through this?
My mom's brothers and sisters, we were a very close-knit family. And they basically were there 24/7, 365 days. They were there all the time, every day. If there's anything that was needed, because my one uncle, he was like the patriarch of the family. He made sure that I had clothes for school. He used to take me to Ideals in town.
Oh,
got uniforms. Me school, got my uniform sorted, school bags, sorted out. My school fees then was, I think, 3 rand or 5 rand, yeah, something like that. I can't even remember. I think it was 2 rand 50, if I'm not mistaken. And he had taken that side of it, and he made sure that my brother and I were supported and seen to, and made sure there was a need for nothing. And then my other uncles used to come with, my aunties used to come with food stuff and grocery stuff, because it was difficult. My dad was the only one working. And they were there. The support base was immense. And that's something that I leaned onto. And in my later years in life, I kind of felt that I owe them. You know, you got that sense of, I need to pay back. But how do I pay back?
Can I ask you, at what age, like, you said your mom passed away when you were 14. I'm going to get to that, how that all transpired. But at what age did you actually realize this is cancer? This is how my mom died, and this is what actually happened. Did you ever, like, get to an age where you realized, oh, sherbet, this is it. This is what my mom had. And did you ever research it to find out?
Okay, that I was in matric. And that was, like, 5 years later. 4 or 5 years later. When the teacher that was the PE teacher at school when my mom passed, I was very close to him because of my footballing talents and stuff. So at matric, he sat me down and he said to me, he asked me, do you know exactly what happened? I said, I'm not too sure. I said, he said, look, he gave me a book and he said, just read this thing here. Honestly, Roz, I cannot remember what I read. But it was something that said, cancer will kill. That's all that stuck in my mind. Cancer will kill. And I said to him, surely, because we get the cold, there's medication. And I just questioned him. He said, you know, his dad apparently passed away. from Sumula Cancer. And he kind of sat me down and he explained to me. And that's when I got very intrigued with cancer itself. Mm. And it's always been close to my heart. Mm. I've always supported cancer days, golf. I've actually organized golf days for cancer back in the day when I was playing, when I was captain of a golf club. And it's something that I want people to understand, that now there is like hope. There is always hope today. But being it then, I never knew. If I had been 21 then, maybe I would have done something, or maybe I would have known better.
Mm. Okay, leading up to the days before your mom passed away, did you ever get like a feeling like this could be happening? She could be passing away. Did she deteriorate to a point where they started preparing you for her passing?
I would say 3 months. She died on the 11th of December, 1982. I'd say August, September. Like I said, my mom was quite a healthy woman. Mm. I'd say August, September, she was down to skin and bones. Mm. And when I say skin and bones, I literally mean skin and bones. I could not even touch her. And her hair was gone, and it was a difficult time in terms of I couldn't look at my mother anymore. Mm-hmm. Because that's not my mother. When I looked at her, I was like angry, but I don't know who I was angry at. And it so happened that the doctor, like I mentioned earlier, Dr. Rambar, he came to our house, I think it was end of November, and he said to my uncle, mid-November, I think, and he said, we're going to have to prepare you guys. This is not going to go well. And my uncles didn't say it to us, but said it to my dad and to my aunties and my granny, and, well, both my grannies were there. And when I saw them cry, that's when I realized this. Yeah. Then I realized, that's it. But it was only a matter of time. And I'll build you up to that day. It was a Friday, the 10th. We finished school. It was the end of year. Mm-hmm. And like I said, my friend said to me, "Yuj, come on, let's go. We're going to town. We're going to go watch a movie." We watched the movie. We came back home. Had supper, did everything, did the normal thing. The next day, in the morning, my auntie was there. And she got up and she was like, no, there's something wrong. She phoned the doctor. Now, by that time, myself and my uncles, well, my cousins were there. We were playing cricket outside. I promise you, we had a little alleyway. We were playing cricket. And I saw the doctor come in. I was just being a child. Sorry.
No, it's fine. No need to be sorry.
Yeah, it's... And by then, most of the family were there. It must have been... 11, 12 o'clock. I just heard people crying inside. And I was summoned by the doctor to come up and to close my mom's eyes. It's the hardest thing for anybody to do. Or for any child to do. Yeah, and that, yeah, that's when I realized, that's it, she's no more. And after that time, and when I closed her eyes, I wasn't even crying. Because I wasn't aware what's going on. Eventually, yeah, I understood the situation. It only dawned on me the day of the funeral, when we got to the cemetery, and being the eldest child, in our tradition, I have to be the one that does the last rites. Mm-hmm. And two of my uncles, one is a great footballer, Duda Munsami, that held on to me, and my cousin Victor, they both had me do the last rites, and then they had to walk me away from the burial site, and I'm not supposed to turn back and look at that. That's when it dawned on me, and that's when I started to cry, because before that it didn't even faze me. Because I saw all the people at home, and because we had the funeral at home, and there were thousands of people. I mean, not thousands, I'm exaggerating, but there was a lot of people, because she was a well-known person. She was, I think I got my personality from my mom, guaranteed. That's 100% guarantee.
I think thousands of people is not an exaggeration, because when you were a child, it must have just been like just people
everywhere.
So that interpretation that she views, that 1,000, I can actually picture it. You are a child and you're overwhelmed and there's just people everywhere. It just must have felt like thousands of people. How old was your mom when she passed away?
38.
She was 38. So she found out she had cancer when she was about
36. But she used to work at Atomic Builders, the hardware store. You know where Macro is now?
Mm-hmm.
Across the road, Interside Avenue?
Yes.
That's where the old Macro, the old Atomic used to be. And when I eventually found out what was the cause, not actually the cause, where she worked, it was a lot of dust and something got into her system. I'm not saying it's that, but that was one of the underlying factors.
That was the next thing that I wanted to ask you. Did the doctors, or did you ever find out afterwards if this type of cancer is hereditary? Because, you know, some cancers are hereditary. So, how do you feel?
I went and did a test before I was 21. Because I was playing football at that time, at a semi-professional level, they wanted us to do some tests and all that. And then while I was at the hospital, I said to the doctor, listen, can I do a cancer test? He said, why? I said, listen, this is a story. And he said, no, okay, fine, we'll do the test. Mm-hmm. And I asked that doctor, I can't even remember his name, but he said to me, it's not an hereditary cancerous thing. He says, that was something that must have just happened. We can't say what the cause was, because I kind of explained to him the symptoms and stuff like that. He said, no, that's not hereditary. And after that, it's just something that I've always wanted to know, is whether I'm going to be that way as well. Mm. It always worried me. I've had a lump on my left thigh, I don't know how long ago now this was, and I got worried. And when I went to the doctors, I think we were married then.
Mm-hmm.
And I went to the doctor, and the doctor did the test. They said, no, it's not cancer. It's just called lipoma, a buildup of excessive fat and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a worry at that time, because I was like, because everybody was talking about, you get a lymph node, you get this.
Lump, yeah.
And you start stressing. Mm-hmm. And it stressed me out more because of my background.
Everybody that we've actually chatted to that has lost someone to cancer has that type of fear.
It is a big fear of mine.
Everyone that we've spoken to, when they experience any type of thing that can be remotely related to a symptom, then you kind of panic.
I am paranoid about it. I'll be honest to you, I am very paranoid about it.
Eugene Sherbert, losing your mom at such a young and tender age, after your mom had passed, how did that impact your life?
It was a big void in my life, a massive void. I'm going to be very honest and spill the beans. My mom passed that year, 1982, and my dad, while my mom was sick, my mom knew that my dad was having an affair at that time, because she used to find these love letters and stuff and all that. And him and I, and she told me, Daddy's got a girlfriend, Daddy. I said, didn't worry me, until when, after she passed, he brings home another lady, my stepmom, with a child that's his. And him and I from that time, I lost all respect for my dad. Because you cannot respect my mom, and you do this to me. And from that time onwards, I lived my life not in my house.
Okay.
I was in Effingham, I was in Kenville by my family. It was a hard life for me in terms of, I used to live out of my football kit bags. Mm-hmm. That was my life.
And your brother, did your brother stay? Or did
he stayed because he was very close to my dad. Mm. But I couldn't forgive my dad for what he did. Mm. Which is, I don't know if it's normal or it's abnormal for a child to hate, not hate, but dislike the parent. But the fact that he disowned us in terms of, he never respected that mourning period for my mom. And as I grew older, it weighed heavier on my mind. And I said, if I had to do that, how would my kids look at it? So that's how I looked at it. But apart from that, it impacted on me immensely because I never had that mother figure. Mm. My mom's elder sister became like a mother figure, and she was there for me all throughout my marriage. They were there. They guided me through my marriage to Mrs. Nibbles. my mom's elder sister was that mother that I didn't have. Because my matric year, my dad kicked me out of the house. I was living in Unit 12, Phoenix. I walked from Unit 12, Phoenix to Unit 8 to my auntie's house. And she took me in, made sure I finished my matric from her house.
Yeah, I'm so happy that you had so much support around you. Can I ask, did you ever think of going for therapy or any kind of psychology? Do you think that even at this point it would be useful to you?
Yeah. I've been to a friend of mine. Well, he's not a psychologist of any sort, but he's a very close friend of mine. Mm-hmm. And we've spoken about this. And he's always said to me, You can go for psychology. Yes, it's going to help you. But do you want to go? I said, no. Mm-hmm. I said, I don't want to speak. You know, I'm just me.
Mm-hmm.
As I'm living my life now, what you see is what you get.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to tell you, hey, this, that, and the other. No, I'm sorry. My life is done there.
Mm-hmm.
That past of mine is there. I've got my family, which I don't want them to go through
mm-hmm.
what I went through.
Totally understandable. Eugene, thank you so much for sharing your journey with us. You
thank
had
you.
Tony Yo. In tears from beginning
Ooh,
to end.
Gosh. Yeah.
From beginning to end. I think this is your favorite part
Guys,
of the show.
Guys, how's this? It is. We're going to get there and we're late. But listen to this. There is a competition here with regards to the amount of tissues that are on this table. And Mr. Nibbles is winning here. He's got more.
I only got two.
He's got more tissues on the table with.
So what do you got?
So guys,
this is not showing. Show us the tissues.
I'm for the eyes. I'm for the nose. Guys, on behalf of the fans, I would like to thank you.
It's been my pleasure.
We've got a goodie that you've seen from the other guys. Good Friday, we would like to thank you guys once again for coming on board. They've blessed us with these gorgeous t-shirts.
Thank you.
So you're going to open your goodie. We're going to play your song. And then...
This was my mom's,
like
one
a,
of my mom's
like
favorite songs.
Adder.
Okay, so this is one of Uncle Eugene's mom's favorite songs.
This is the light up the comments department. Can you believe it? Because I'm more concerned about how many tissues you got. Guys, you know what to do. It is light up the comments department. You are going to blow up the comments department. Pink cards if you would like to. Okay, follow Roz. If you would like to send a words of encouragement, do it to Mr. Nibbles. I see some of you guys have done that already. Please drop it now, guys. This is your time to shine. So you're going to we want to see all these goodies lighting up the screen here. Yeah? Hit the love button. Liz, I see you there. What? Good morning, good evening. Lincoln, we see you as well. Guys, blow up the comments department. Let's go.
I feel you touch me in the pouring rain. And the moment that you wander far from me, I want to feel you in my arms again. And you come to me on a summer breeze, keep me warm in your love, then you softly leave, and it's me you need to show. How deep is your love? How deep is your love? How deep is your love? I really need to learn, 'cause we're living in a world of fools, breaking us down when they are.
I know the Bee Gees is going to flag us. We must probably mute it after the minute we end the show. But on behalf of the fan zone, we would like to thank Mr. Nibbles for coming on board. Eugene, thank you so much.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much for coming on board and for sharing your story with us. We were just talking, you know, in our ad break. And Roz actually said what I was going to come back onto the stream and say, like, She looked at Eugene and she was like, sure, I couldn't believe it, guys. we don't know people's stories. We see them and they're happy-go-lucky and everything's all cheerful, good, and, you know, there's like, they've got no care in the world. And we look at Mr. Nibbles, for example, who has lost his mom at a tender age, hasn't even spoken about it, hasn't even shared the story since then. But also another thing I picked up is you can remember everything. Guys, trauma for me, blank out certain things. I don't know if I'd be able to sit back and speak about when I lost my gran or when I lost certain people in my lives. You brought back an entire scene.
I think you will. I think because it's hasn't... I know you've lost your gran.
Yeah, but people blank out certain things.
I know, because I lost my dad. When I think I was... I just turned 4 when I lost my dad. But I remember that day.
Like yesterday.
It was yesterday. And there was even a point of my life where there was stuff that I remembered. And I just sit and I think, is this a memory? Or is this just stuff put together by things that I've heard? You know? Because you kind of get to an age where you think, you don't know if it's a memory or if someone told you or or where it basically is. But it's a known fact that anything traumatic, you kind of remember, and you remember markers from that day, you remember certain people, it just all comes back.
I remember, like I said, I remember that cricket. Cricket is something that will always be close to me, because that day we were playing cricket. And that's all I know.
But we're in trauma situations, you might not remember it straight away, but as your life goes on, things trigger and you start picking up. And sometimes
you get those triggers.
Yeah, you can't remember, is it a memory? Did I really experience this? Or, you know, you come try and figure it out for yourself. But I want to read out Tyler's comment. She says that, stay strong, Mr. Nibbles. You're such a brave person to come and share your story with everyone. Sending lots of love and prayers your way.
Thank you, Tyler.
And I think, Mr. Nibbles, there is quite a few here that we need
Auntie
to go
G's
through.
Auntie G's is a real touching story to share with us. Thank you, Eugene.
Thank you, Auntie G.
Oh, but what you must do is, if you go back and you read the stream and you go through the comments, because some of the comments actually don't come up on our side,
but
and
maybe
then
Vanessa's not on. Sorry, it's the check.
Okay,
the check,
so Tyler actually says that's her. She can't stand trauma, so she blanks out on a lot of stuff. So maybe it is a reaction to trauma.
Okay, we've got a Hayden Bowers in the stream. Good evening to you and welcome to Let's Talk at the Fan Zone. He says, really amazing story shared. Thanks for the sharing. Thanks for sharing your experience. Really a touching story. So, Mr. Nibbles, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, guys, we're going to recap.
Hayden Bowers is actually the father of the little boy that we met.
Oh, okay. All right.
The Bowers family?
Yes.
From Sydney?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Okay, guys, so we're going to recap a few things that we spoke about at the beginning of the show. Some of the guys won in the stream. First and foremost, we got our shave-a-thon, our final shave-a-thon.
I can't believe it.
No, neither can I.
Tony has been speaking about this for 3 months and is going to come to an end. This is the last time. The last time that she's going to do it. Okay, so are you coming to... Oh, she's gone to get the prize.
Okay, guys. Sorry, we're just gonna... can y'all see? I don't even know.
Yes, they can. Yeah. There you go.
Can we just, like, mine kick you, Jean, like, somewhere out that screen?
Okay? No, okay, take it
okay,
away.
Guys, so this is the story. This is our good... excuse me. This is our goodie from Modern Hair and Beauty. It is a male and female treatments set.
There's brushes
sponsored from them.
There's loads of products
and a beach bag. Now we are raffling this off. It's starting at 20 rand a ticket, and we're gonna do the draw live on Sunday. Times will be discussed by Saturday. Times will be dropped. Yesterday. We normally go live at 12 and then maybe at about 3-ish.
Okay.
So yes, please, if you guys have not bought a ticket and would like to buy a ticket, please drop us a message. You guys can WhatsApp me, whatever the case may be. See, the numbers are taking 5 tickets. Thank you very much.
We got five. Do we have six?
Guys, how is this? Princey was in the stream. Princey was in the stream earlier. He has bought 25 tickets. So a huge shout out to him.
Hey, thank you, Princey.
The one that has bought.
Guys, also in our sponsors. One of our sponsors who actually sponsored us all of our water for boat shaverdons is Itaquini Secure.
Yes.
Oh, cool.
And then so just
Itaquini Secure came to the
Robin,
party.
Robin, how many tickets you buying? You want this thing? I'll courier it for you if you win. Buy all the sheets.
No, you can give it to our mum.
Whoa, mama, go eat the stuff.
Her mum would love this
stuff.
But
that stuff won't help
me. It'll help Vanessa and Tanu.
I even just got
here. And Tristan, because it's male and female.
And Elizabeth.
You can.
And Elizabeth.
Yeah, Lizzie. Can have a good time there. So guys, please, man, come through, support us. All those proceedings will go to the cancer lady that will be with us on Sunday. Guys, even if you came to the first one at DJ Hairdressing on the 3rd of October, you're more than welcome to come and see us on Sunday. So please, make it a road trip. Get all your buddies together. Come through, take a snap, spray your hair. Or you don't have to spray and you don't have to shave, but come and buy a raffle ticket at least, or a few. Make it worth the while. So, let me know. I'm going to drop my cell phone number in the comments department. Please message me. 61630. Please send me a WhatsApp how many tickets you would like, and then we'll arrange what's moving and shaking with regards to payments and all those 101 things. All right. Five tickets for NCG. Thank you.
We got five. Do we have six?
We can do an auction here. Can do an auction here.
Okay, guys. So all the proceeds are going to cancer on every single thing. So the shave-a-thon proceeds will go to cancer. And guys, remember, we are trying to beat our target, which is 20K. We are trying to raise 20K. We already have 8K. 9K. You already have 9.5K.
9.5.
Yeah.
Okay, so guys, remember that even
eight
if you...
cash and 1,000 EFT and 500 EFT.
Oh.
Okay, so guys, even if you cannot make it to the cancer shave-a-thon on Sunday...
Kathy with the IKEA bags, he forgot to mention you. Kathy wants
you
10 tickets.
You keep cutting me off.
Is there anybody that's taking 15 tickets?
We got 10. There's any. We have
Thank
11.
You. Thank you, Kathy.
Then you just jump in. Okay, well, I even forgot what I wanted to say.
That's fine.
Because you, like, just cut me off.
I got excited.
Okay, so... what I wanted to say before I was so rudely interrupted was, even if you cannot make it to the Cancer Shave-a-thon on Sunday, we will post Cancer's banking details. You can always do your deposit of any amount in that account. As long as you put the fan zone as your reference, that will go towards our target. So you can still
10 tickets for Vanessa. Guys, can we get someone that's coming through with 11 tickets, or someone that's coming through with 12 tickets or 15 tickets? Also, while we've got the IKEA bag, while we've got Kathy Beck here, what a beautiful write-up that you had in the North Glen News, number one. Number two.
Yay, I saw that.
Number two, stunning. Guys, remember, if you would like to purchase IKEA bags, it's $250. All Kathy's details are on the fan zone page. Please drop her WhatsApp, and her banking details are on there as well. Remember, that bag actually gets given to a cancer patient, and it's got all the goodies that they need while they're going through chemo.
We got 15! Thank you, baby!
Yay!
We got 15! Do we have 20?
I have screenshots that, you know, all these. Thank you. Right. I'm gonna, yeah. Anyone with the 50, what number, what are we on 50? Anyone with 20? Robin, where are you that you want this thing? Come through with your 25 tickets, Robin? Robin May? Quiet.
Okay, so since we're not doing numbers, I think what we're going to do is your 15 tickets will be 15 times into the draw.
Yeah.
So what we're going to do is you put all your names in and then someone will pick it out, because I think numbers is not going to work. So 15, how many tickets you buy will get you
how many inches
into the draw. 100%. I think that'll be a better way that we're going to work it. Okay, so are we time? It's 3 minutes left. Just to the top of the hour. When last have you said that? Tony, that was Tony's words. Okay, we've got 3 minutes
to
the top of the hour. No, I'm just saying.
Are you bored?
I'm not bored. I'm just thinking.
Guys,
I've noticed
Roz is doing everything that I think I do to her on the show. She's doing it to me today.
On TG, we will send you the banking details.
Yeah, okay, no problem, no problem. Right, guys, that is us. We are out. We're not playing out in any songs. We're muted from the Bee Gees. Thank you for your beautiful song.
Are we muted? That is a beautiful song. I love
that song.
I wasn't
being sarcastic.
Oh, okay.
You sure?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so, yes! Robin came through with 20 tickets! Yes,
we need a pew, pew, pew!
Thank you. That's all we
do. Do we have 25?
Okay, guys, let's see. You've got 2 minutes to come through and tell me that someone is taking 25 tickets. We're gonna wait. Actually, we're not even going off. So sort yourself.
Excuse me? We've got load shedding just now. I need to go iron uniforms and do
guys,
everything.
We've got 30 seconds. Can somebody please, there's Jody, pew pew pew.
Oh, there we go, there's our pew pew pew.
Can somebody come, okay guys, even if it's 2 tickets, I'll take it. Can somebody come through and tell me that they're taking 2 tickets, at least 2 tickets, then we can end the stream. Come on, where are y'all? Who else is in the stream here? Let me see here. Who never buy a ticket?
Hello.
Let me see. Who else?
Ooh,
never buy?
I thought she's looking at Vanessa. I'm just getting, I was
another
just
five.
Thinking.
Okay, we are out. Good night. Thank you. And we will catch you guys on Sunday for our shave it done.
Our last one.
Oh, did you sing 10 tickets? Can I get a pew, pew, pew?
Woo!
Nice. Thank you, guys. Okay, so we... How do you send money? Okay, friend, please... you and Robin must talk together there. Maybe you can also come through and buy a ticket or two for our raffle. Alright, guys, we are gonna love and leave you. By the way, our matriculants started writing.
Yes.
So while I'm on this platform, thank you, Wendy, second 10 tickets. Okay, so while I'm on this platform, I'm gonna chat to Roz. I'm gonna interview Roz for the next 3 seconds. How does it feel to have a kid writing finals? Just a quick, brief one.
Guys,
send me money also. Shizzy, come through and buy a ticket. You're asking people for money.
Okay,
guys, just Roz, talk to us. How does it
you
feel?
Want to interrupt me, but you want me to talk.
No, yes, I walked into Jada's life and she was coming. She was going into high school.
And she's still in primary school.
So I've literally walked a complete
high school journey.
I'm feeling old, but like, I'm like, wow. But yeah, besides watching her grow, like, she's grown. She's literally like, yeah, now I think for me. But like, Candace, Roz, and myself are in a group. And this morning they were like, in their fields and stuff like that. Like, what does it feel like? What does it feel like to have a kid that is matriculating?
You know what? This morning I wasn't in my fields. I was nervous. And anybody that has a child that starts to matric, you know, you understand. You're not in your fields. You're just like nervous. Is she ready? Like, how is she going to do in the paper?
Did you take notice? Roz's glasses are back, blank. Guys. You know, she's got the
fields.
Anyway.
If you want me to talk, let me speak.
I don't want to go.
The
man.
Feelings part, guys, the feelings part was at the last assembly, the prize giving, speech day. I literally teared from beginning to end. We went to our last ever prize giving for Jada. It was like, and also being COVID, only one parent is allowed, or one family member is allowed. And my sister and I usually used to go to each other's kids. Like, my sister always came to my kids' prize giving. So, you know, you're crying together and you're nudging and it's like, oh, look at this. Oh, and you're sitting there by yourself and the next parent is far from you and it's like so lonely.
I did bear was checking 30 tickets. Pew, 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 pew.
Ooh, I can't see that. How did you see that? Can you not ask me a question and then interrupt me when I'm in the middle of my fields?
Tickets are sending you.
Anyway, guys, so tomorrow is, it was English today, so it wasn't so bad. There's other parents in this
okay, friend,
as well.
The tickets are $20. We're asking guys to donate towards that hamper, so that, well, buy tickets for the raffle, and all the money that we raise from that raffle, as well, will go through to cancer. So we're trying to sell as many entries into for that raffle kind of a thing for Sunday. So it will be raffled live. So if you're buying 3 tickets, then your name, it's like 3 entries basically. If you're buying 10, whatever, so forth. So, yes.
Okay, I'm done with my story because you keep
interrupting. But I'm sorry, man.
No, you keep interrupting. You got 2 minutes.
I'm just worried. Like, I'm going to get it.
I was feeling so emo, and then every time I'm about to express myself, so I'm like, yeah.
Okay, I'm going to keep quiet. Can you just pause?
No, the moment's gone. I don't want to do it anymore. Moment's gone.
Can you see it now, guys?
Mama,
it was Jody, because I also didn't see the other 10 or whatever.
Oh, so Jody, she's blaming you. She's blaming you, Jody's.
Motherfucking pew. And I'm like, what's going on in this? I thought I missed. Okay, guys, we are out. She's calling you the popcorn lady.
Oh my gosh. No, stop it, Jody.
Okay, we are out. We are out. Hit Euphoria Bespoke with 5 tickets there, please. I can just hear you say that. Pew, 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 pew. Okay, now, guys, we are going. It's already 4 minutes past 7. Much love to you guys. Thank you so much. I think we can do auctions like this. You know what I'm saying? Okay, she doesn't know what I'm saying. Okay, guys.
No.
Peace and love. They were friends. 20 tickets. Pew, 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 pew. Why am I only doing? And you know.
I'm still gutted that you keep asking me
a
question.
You ask the question and you just...
And then you just carry
on. No, but you said you're finished now with the question. With
yes, the I'm not speaking about that anymore because you just like...
You got me in trouble now. Guys, we are out. Much love to you guys. Enjoy the rest of your week. We will catch you guys on Sunday.